next on Unsolved Mysteries. A cold-blooded murder leads to a high-speed chase and a dramatic shootout with the police. The killer is still on the run. After 20 years of marriage, John Burns falls in love with another woman, and then he kills her. A woman who gave up her children and checked into a mental hospital may not know that she's an heir to a million-dollar estate. And many believe that this young woman has performed miracles while confined to her bed in a coma. Murder, missing persons, wanted fugitives, and the paranormal. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries.
Check cashed. I've got $200 in my wallet. Just reach in the back.
James Rouse Jr. was a teacher, a husband, and a father of two young children. And he was abducted at gunpoint by two fugitives, William Jordan and Anthony Prevett. Both men were wanted in North Carolina for a series of robberies.
Turn around that way. You've got my money. Don't.
The ride ended on a remote back road at the edge of a forest. The kidnappers forced James Rouse to march barefoot into the woods. When they reached the shore of the deserted lake, they stopped. James Rouse died instantly, shot at point-blank range with a sawed-off shotgun. The next day, Wadesboro, North Carolina, 240 miles from Suwanee.
That's it over there. 421.
Police got a tip that Jordan and Prevett had returned and were hiding at the home of a friend.
You recognize that car?
Nah, it doesn't look familiar to me.
Prevett and Jordan had a reputation of being predominantly into property theft, housebreaking, those type of things. We didn't really suspect that they were involved in anything serious other than that.
When deputies approached the house, Jordan and Prevett were already one step ahead of them.
Sheriff's Office 107 in pursuit of suspects traveling east on Highway 117. Suspects are firing upon us, requesting backup.
Everything was happening so fast, but it seemed extreme that these guys were using this much excessive force to get away from us just because we wanted to talk to them about some house break-ins.
Get a shot! Get a shot! Suspect has thrown out what looks like to be a weapon just past the church. I'm going to pull on something.
Anthony Prevett and William Jordan were booked on charges of breaking and entering, larceny, and assaulting officers with a firearm. But what the sheriff didn't know is that the two men they had just arrested were also cold-blooded killers. 48 hours later, the body of James Rouse was discovered near the lake in Georgia. Jordan and Prevett had stolen his car, then wrecked it during their attempted getaway in North Carolina. A shotgun shell found near the murder scene sealed the case against Jordan and Prevett. Ballistics revealed that Rouse had been killed with a blast from the same shotgun the pair had dumped during the chase. Inside the wrecked car, police found trophies of the murder in Georgia. Photos of Jordan and Privat leaning against Ross's car, posing with that same shotgun that killed him.
They were both eventually extradited back to Georgia, tried, both found guilty of first-degree murder, both given the death sentence.
But neither Jordan nor Privat stayed on death row. The Georgia Supreme Court reduced their sentences to life in prison. It wasn't long before Privat was paroled. Soon after, he murdered his girlfriend and was returned to prison. Once again, he was sentenced to death, and this time, the sentence stood.
Jordan, you and Green take the truck on back to the house, gas it up, make yourself useful.
Yes, sir.
After 10 years in prison, Jordan was assigned to a minimum security work farm for good behavior. But his image as a model prisoner proved to be misleading. One day, Jordan just kept driving. A month later, police caught the inmate who escaped with him, but Jordan remains at large.
He possibly works in West Virginia as a heavy equipment operator. He also possibly has a family in West Virginia. He uses the name William Bill Jordan or William Jr. Jordan.
Decades have passed since Jordan and Privat murdered James Rouse Jr., but the Rouse family still feels the pain.
The hardest part has been not only the way it happened, but certainly the fact that he has not been with us and been able to enjoy his own family. We have lived through years of anger for what Jordan did to my brother-in-law, Jim, and what it has done to the children as well as to his wife.
This is how William Jordan looked at the time he murdered James Rouse. And this is a computer-aged photo of Jordan. He is 6 feet 2 inches tall, has brown graying hair, and probably wears glasses. Jordan has several distinctive tattoos, including a spider on his right arm and a cross with the name Sybil on his left. If you have any information that could help put William Jordan back in prison, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, no one guessed that their quiet, unassuming neighbor of 20 years was filled with murderous rage. South Lyon, Michigan. John Burns was a married man when he fell in love with Eleanor Farber. When she found out that he was married, Eleanor ended the relationship. No one guessed that John Burns would soon turn violent. John Burns drifted into town in 1947. He had little more than his name and the clothes on his back. But Burns never revealed much about his past to his friends or his neighbors.
Well, I was neighbors with him for probably several years. I never spoke 200 words with the man all the time I lived by him.
He certainly was very careful about what he would tell you and what he would talk about. So yes, if he had something to hide, I'm certainly sure he did it very well.
I really don't know where John Burns was from, nor do I know when he was born. As a matter of fact, I can't be positive that John Burns was born in the United States.
1 year after Burns arrived, a woman named Ann McMurray fell in love with him, and soon they were married.
I don't know why John married Anna. John looked about 20 years younger than Anna. Perhaps he legitimately loved her at the time. Perhaps John married this woman to help cover his identity, help cover his trail.
After 20 years of marriage, Burns met and fell in love with Eleanor Farber. Eleanor had no idea that John had a wife in South Lyon, only 15 miles away.
The affair between John and Eleanor was common knowledge throughout the area. You know, it was no big secret. Most anybody that knew John knew that John and Eleanor were having an affair.
Come on, Pokey. Come on.
Okay.
Get her up here.
Well, at first, John Burns treated her very well. He was good to the kids, brought him a pony. He bought her things, made her feel good. She dreamed of having a farm and raising animals. She liked chickens.
Yeah. What do you call these two?
Well, that one over there is Betsy and then Lulu.
It was nice to see her happy again. She felt like her dreams were gonna come true.
Oh, what a nice day.
He told her he was going to marry her. They made plans to get married. They made plans to buy a chicken ranch. John Burns and Eleanor Farver went to a local doctor in South Lyon for blood tests in anticipation of getting a marriage license and getting married.
Several months into the affair, Burns stopped by his house with Eleanor in the car. It was the first time that Eleanor ever saw Anna.
Who's that lady?
That's my aunt.
Your aunt?
Uh-huh.
We had no reason really to doubt him. And of course, looking at her, she looked old enough to be his aunt. He told Eleanor that she was a hard to get along woman, and that was his reason for not taking Eleanor in to introduce him. I mean, he spent most of his time with her. Who would have thought that he had a wife? She decided one day to go to his house and take some things that she was actually borrowing from him. And I think she was curious about this woman in the house.
I'm Eleanor. Are you John's aunt?
She interrupted her and told her who she was.
I'm his fiancée.
I'm his wife.
That day, Eleanor swore that she would never see John Burns again.
Eleanor, I knew you were in there!
John would come to the door and bang on the door, pleading with her to explain. And Eleanor wouldn't. She would not see him.
Eleanor!
Over the course of 5 months, John Burns unleashed his anger on Eleanor Farber. He wrote threatening letters and pushed them under her door at night. He tried to run Eleanor off the road, and he told her that he planned to blow up her house.
Eleanor! Eleanor!
I don't remember what day of the week it was. I'm not exactly sure. I don't even remember the exact time of the day, but it was in the middle of the day. And John came in, and he wasn't too familiar with shotguns.
Got a dog in the neighborhood that's been giving me some trouble.
He said he had a German Shepherd that was bothering him. And he wanted something to shoot him with. What do you want to do? Just dust him off, or do you want to kill him?
Kill him.
Well, the buck will do the job. I sell shells like that every day of the week to somebody.
On the day of the murder, Burns saw a car that he did not recognize in Eleanor's driveway. The car actually belonged to Eleanor's cousin. But Burns just assumed that it was owned by another lover.
Eleanor, listen, you've been holding out on me. I know you got another man, Eleanor.
I was sitting at the table, and he was right outside the window, probably not more than 10 feet away.
Put that away!
And when I seen him loading the gun and talking, I could see the anger in his face. He was talking fast. I knew. That's why I ran for our gun. And by that time, it was too late. If he couldn't have her, he didn't want anyone else to have her either.
It wasn't too long after that that we heard that John had done his girlfriend in. And of course, boy, everybody was shocked. It was just absolutely, couldn't believe it.
After the murder, Burns disappeared from sight, but not from South Lyon. The police couldn't find him, but Burns was seen in town on three separate occasions. Police would later learn that for 10 days, Burns had been hiding in a barn that was less than 100 yards from the murder scene. When police finally searched the hayloft in the barn, they found the remote area where John Burns had been hiding. They discovered dozens of empty food cans and a confession to the murder scrawled on wooden slats, but Burns had already vanished. Ever since Eleanor Farber was killed, Detective Bill Eskridge has been relentless in his pursuit of John Burns. He has sifted through dozens of documents from every state in the Union. Despite all this, Detective Eskridge has come up empty-handed. He has found no record of a John Burns who matches the description of the man who killed Eleanor Farber. This is a photograph of Burns with Eleanor Farber. There is only one other picture police have been able to find of Burns.
In my opinion, John Burns definitely was trying to hide a past. I believe that he was on the run from authorities in another state, possibly even another country, for a very serious crime. In an effort to find additional pictures of John Burns, I went to the South Line High School where he had been employed and looked through all of the yearbooks. For 8 years in a row, every day the photographs were to be taken, John Burns called in sick. He never let himself be photographed. I think it's very conceivable that John Burns is still alive and maybe even watching this TV show. He was a survivalist. He was incredibly crafty. And I think John Burns is out there somewhere.
Update. John Burns eluded authorities for 17 years. Shortly after this story aired, Burns was arrested in Altoona, Pennsylvania, and charged with the murder of Eleanor Farber. The jury found him guilty, but Burns died of a heart attack before he could be sentenced. Next, a deputy sheriff is shot down in his own home. Police are looking for the caller who said that he could identify the gunman. Burbank, California. Charlie Anderson was a 14-year veteran of the Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department. A highly skilled driver, Charlie taught hundreds of deputies how to handle their vehicles in dangerous situations.
Charlie was probably one of the most talented drivers that I've ever met. It was a natural talent for him. Charlie was able to get along with everybody. He was serious on the job, but he had a good sense of humor when he was around the rest of the staff.
Charlie was also a dedicated father, never too busy to spend evenings and weekends with his two sons. To those who knew him, Charlie didn't seem to have an enemy in the world, until he was shot and killed in his own home. Beth, Charlie's wife, told police that on the night of the murder, the couple and their two sons got home around midnight.
Oh, honey, he's out like a light.
Well, I'll go ahead and bring him upstairs, and then I'll come back for you and the baby.
Okay, thanks.
They arrived home, and because Mrs. Anderson was suffering from a back injury, her husband offered to go inside the house with her oldest boy first. He asked her to wait in the car, and she did so. Charlie Anderson went in the house with the oldest son, and we believe took him upstairs. A few moments later, Mrs. Anderson heard what sounded like backfires from where she was parked in the driveway. She was still seated in the car. Because the sound was unusual, she walked to the house and called in to see if there was anything wrong.
Honey, are you up here? Charlie, can you hear me?
She ran downstairs, picked up her younger son, and ran to a next-door neighbor's house.
Police at the scene found the Andersons' older son unharmed. Their first impression was that Charlie had surprised a burglar and had been shot. But there were other signs that the burglary had been staged.
While they had selected certain items and placed them together to be taken from the house, they had overlooked other items that were much more valuable that were in plain sight. This led to a second theory that this might have been someone that perhaps knew Deputy Anderson that confronted him and shot him.
Charlie's sister believes that's exactly what happened. She was at the crime scene that night, called there by a neighbor.
But what really surprised me was the look on his face. He had a wide-eyed look, as if he'd been shocked or betrayed. It's something that lingers with me today.
In the end, the evidence collected at the crime scene was ambiguous at best. The only fingerprints were from members of the family. Police were left with a murder victim and virtually no leads until a mysterious phone call one day later. The following is a reenactment of that conversation taken from the police transcript of the call.
Burbank Police Department, may I help you?
Yes. May I speak to the officer in charge, please?
Sure. We're regarding what type of incident?
This is some information that might lead to the killer that shot the deputy sheriff.
Okay, wait a minute. Hang on just a second.
At that time, the investigator handling the case was in the station, and he was called to the dispatch area so he could speak with the person that had called in.
I know who did the shooting.
Okay, the watch commander's on his way down here to answer the phone, okay?
I can't wait too long.
Okay, here's the detective handling the case right now. Hang on just a second.
Hi there. What can I do for you?
Is this being recorded?
Yes, it is.
I can't speak to you if this is recorded.
Okay, why don't I give you the number of my office where it is not recorded? I'm not going to lie to you, okay?
I don't like recordings.
The man on the line was very, very nervous. He was very concerned about his voice being taped, about him being, the call being traced, or in any way the police identifying who he was.
I'm not playing around.
Well, that call could not be connected to an unrecorded line. So the detective asked the witness to hang up and call back.
Well, as I said, you're going to have to give me about 2 minutes to get back to my office.
All right.
Okay.
The man agreed, bye-bye. But the phone call never came. Charlie Anderson was laid to rest with the full honors reserved for officers killed in the line of duty. Lack of evidence has dragged the investigation to a standstill, and police are still searching for the unidentified caller.
We feel it's very, very important to locate this caller because he was concerned enough to call us right at the beginning of the investigation. He has never been identified, and we're very, very interested in speaking to him to find out what he does know about this case.
The killer that shot the deputy sheriff.
Burbank police believe the mysterious phone call is their best hope to close the case. A $25,000 reward is being offered, and police have guaranteed that the identity of anyone coming forward will be held in the strictest confidence. If you have any information that can help solve the murder of Deputy Charlie Anderson, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, after an extraordinary visit to her sister, a young woman walks away and disappears. And now, she's an heir to a million-dollar fortune. Our next story profiles a woman named Laureen Roberts. Her family hasn't seen or heard from her in more than 30 years. Laureen has no way of knowing that she is one of the heirs to a million-dollar estate. Laureen Roberts grew up in Dripping Springs, Texas. She was on the high school basketball team and was a member of the pep club. But at the age of 16, Laureen suddenly dropped out of high school. Her family believes that this was the beginning of a slow descent into mental illness.
Laureen was very quiet. She would just be to herself with her own thoughts and her own world. It's as if she wasn't there with you most of the time.
Hey, little lady, can we get some coffee over here? Yeah, you, the pretty one. You wanna take our order?
In 1949, Laureen dropped out of high school. She moved to Austin and found work as a waitress. She also found love.
Coffee? Pie, how about I take you for a whirl?
I don't know what you mean.
Let me show you.
Just 10 days after they met, Laureen and the young serviceman were married. Laureen and her husband had 3 children in 7 years. In 1956, her husband was discharged from the service, and they moved to his hometown in New Jersey. It wasn't long before Lorene's life began to unravel.
Lorene told me that she wasn't happy there. His family didn't accept her, and that his mother bought her and the children a train ticket and put them on the train to send her back to Austin.
Lorene's husband filed for divorce. With no money and no means of support, Lorene and her three young children returned to Texas and an uncertain future.
I'm tired. When are we going to go home?
Soon. We'll be home.
Michael, sweetheart, would you put this on for me? That other one's dirty. Come here, put this on for Mommy.
Lorene tried. She worked and she tried to handle, you know, her situations. And she loved her children very much. But that was just something she couldn't handle, and she seen she couldn't handle it. And she tried to get help from her husband, but no help. She decided the best thing to do was to just give them up and let them be adopted out where they would be taken care of.
Now don't fuss. We'll get you some food. Now don't fuss. I want you to sit there quietly.
After the children were adopted, Lorene's emotional state became even more fragile.
She came to me and she admitted that she was sick and said she needed help, said she needed a doctor. And my dad said, Ruby, take her to the psychiatrist, and I did. And he gave her admittance to the state hospital. So I took her out there, and she cried and everything when she hugged my neck and loved me and everything, and it was so hard to have to leave her there.
Between 1957 and 1961, Lorene was admitted to the state mental hospital five different times. And then one day, Lorene showed up at her sister Ruby's house, unannounced.
Well, then sit down here and tell me what's been going on.
I'm getting married.
Married? Uh-huh. That's great. Who to?
College professor.
A college professor. Well, that's great.
I came to show you my ring.
Well, that's mighty pretty, honey. Where'd you meet a college professor?
It's pretty, isn't it?
Lorene, where'd you meet a college professor?
The college.
At that time, I was just hoping the best for her. So I didn't question too much or anything. I just hoped the best, you know. And that's the last time I've saw Lorene, and I haven't heard from her or anything since.
Well, I gotta get going.
Well, can I take you somewhere?
Oh, no, I came in a cab, and I'm gonna leave in a cab.
Take care now. Okay, you too. Bye-bye.
2 weeks later, Ruby received a bill for Lorene's engagement ring. Lorene had bought the ring herself and then failed to make the payments.
We have searched everything looking for Lorene. All the public records have been searched. No one has any records of Lorene being alive for the last 25 years. Her mother died in 1988, and her will provided for the distribution of her estate, which was valued at about $1 million, to her children. And Lorene was one of the children. And so since no one knew where she was, the court appointed me to represent her and to try to locate her. I don't think it's going to be easy to find Lorene, but I also don't think she's disappeared off the face of the earth. I think she's out there somewhere.
There's a big void in our life without her. And not knowing whether she's alive or dead, then we want that filled.
I would share her children that have found us and her grandchildren. That would be the first thing I'd want her to know about. She would be so happy.
Update. After we broadcast this story, operators at our telecenter were surprised when Lorene called in to solve her own mystery. Lorene's family was overjoyed to learn that she was still alive and well. Her sister Ruby immediately flew to Little Rock, Arkansas, where Lorene had been working as a housekeeper. A few days later, Ruby brought Lorene back to Austin, Texas, for a reunion with the rest of her family.
It was unbelievable.
I could hardly believe it, because I guess for so long we had searched and searched for her and we couldn't find a lead. I cried, I laughed, I did everything.
Yes, it's getting nice to be back. They're real nice. They've always been. They're original people, they said, that are very darling people.
After the reunion, Laureen received her share of the inheritance. She has since returned to her home in Arkansas.
This is the wonderful person we looked for 30 years.
We're going to try to be happy and just do all the things we can to be together and love each other, which I think will be real good for Laureen and all of us.
Coming up, the story of a young girl in a coma who some believe holds the miraculous power to heal. For Sharon Stevens of La Puente, California, childhood was a never-ending cycle of loneliness and abuse. Her mother died when she was just 3 months old, and Sharon suffered severe beatings at the hands of her alcoholic father. Sharon was finally taken away from her father and later sent to live with foster parents Bill and Cynthia Zielinski. At the Zielinski's home, Sharon experienced love and kindness for the very first time.
They really knew how to parent, and they went all out to make me happy. I felt very special for one of the first times in my whole life. So I started to change in the right way. They taught me respect. They taught me how to respect other people and myself, and they brought my self-esteem up, and because I had a very low self-esteem about myself.
But only 1 year after she arrived, Sharon's happy life with Bill and Cynthia came to an end. A court decided that she should be returned to her father. Sharon never saw Bill and Cynthia again, but she has not forgotten how their love and understanding inspired her.
I know if it hadn't been for them, I probably would have been a child abuser, a drug addict, a prostitute. I feel I would have turned out very bad if it hadn't been for them.
We think a lot of you already.
I would like to be reunited with the Zielinskis to tell them how much I appreciate what they've done for me in the past. And it's a dream, a hope, a fantasy, whatever you want to call it, but I've got to find these people and I've got to say thank you.
Update. Just minutes after her story aired, Sharon's search came to an end. Bill and Cynthia Zielinski were watching the broadcast and called our phone center. After more than 30 years of being apart, Sharon arrived at Bill and Cynthia's house.
Hi, Sharon. Hi. Oh, Sharon. Oh, it's so cool.
Bill and Cynthia were taken by surprise when they saw this story.
Nice to see you. When you see a part of your life history unfolding on national television, your mind goes blank. You don't hear anything else that's going on, but your mind goes back to 30 years ago and all the memories that it brings back.
I was very optimistic that someone out there, their friends, relatives, neighbors, someone, if not theirself, would see it. And I was very surprised that they themselves called in. And I just got goosebumps when I found out, and I still get goosebumps.
Okay, everybody smile and give me a pretty...
For Sharon, the reunion with Bill and Cynthia was a long-awaited chance to say thank you for the inspiration and the courage they gave her as a young girl.
Making a difference in somebody's life is nice. You feel like there was a reason for what happened. At the time, you don't know it, but now you realize there was a reason for what happened. And we'll meet as well.
It's the only dream that I've ever had, is to find the Zielinski, and it feels great. and it's like a dream come true.
Accounts of miraculous healings have been around for as long as faith itself, but some have questions about these reports. Today, many still wonder what to make of them. The story of Audrey Santo is a case in point.
Worcester, Massachusetts.
As you can see, this is Audrey's room, and the person sitting down on her left is her grandmother, and the person standing on your right is one of the nurses.
This is not a reenactment. Audrey has been in a coma-like state called akinetic mutism for years. Every week, people line up at this window to get a glimpse of her. Not out of morbid curiosity, but because they believe that Audrey is a miracle worker. Audrey's astonishing story began when she was playing near the family swimming pool. She was just 3 years old when tragedy struck. Audrey was underwater for several minutes before she was rescued by her brother. On the way to the emergency room, she went into cardiac arrest.
Audrey's initial diagnosis after the near drowning was that she had massive brain damage from the drowning. And very poor prognosis. They didn't think she was going to live very long.
We just started praying. That's all. Just prayed. Because when things are totally out of your control, what else can you do? It's God's control. Then you got to give him the ball and let him run with it.
Audrey survived, but she has remained bedridden. She is aware of her surroundings, but is unable to move or talk.
She's not fully conscious by any stretch of the imagination, and yet she's not unconscious.
A year after Audrey's accident, her mother took her to the famous miracle site of Medjugorje, hoping for a cure. The trip nearly killed Audrey, but her family says that from that time on, a gradual progression of unexplained phenomena took place. One of the most remarkable occurred in their home when Audrey was just 9 years old.
Hey, Mom.
They said that a picture of the Virgin Mary appeared to be crying, not tears, but drops of oil.
We're all looking at this image, and I said, please, you know, if this is for Audrey, let us know this, because all of a sudden it occurred just to the kids and I that maybe this weeping was for Audrey's healing.
There are many meanings of oil, for example, healing and so on, and I conclude quickly then that God is saying, this is a holy place, and this little girl is mine.
It started with one picture. Then, as days went by, the Santo family reported that almost every religious icon in Audrey's room began to cry tears of oil.
Another image started weeping, and then another image started weeping. We started thinking, well, is there a rhyme or reason to this?
Or could this be just a hoax? One person who thought it was a sham was a newly hired nurse.
When I started piecing everything together, at first I'm saying, I gotta get out of here. These guys are nuts. I really tried to call their bluff on this. But as I stayed there, I believed it. I couldn't find any reason why these things are happening, and I have checked. I checked the statues, I checked the cups. I mean, I'm looking for wires and anything that would set off an oil reaction. And there was absolutely nothing, nothing there that I can explain why it's happening.
News spread quickly within the Catholic community. Believers began to request samples of the oil. When some of them anointed sick loved ones with it, the mysterious events reportedly took on a new dimension. Caitlin McQuay was thought to have cerebral palsy. She no longer has braces on her legs and can now go roller skating. Victor Finucci says that he recovered from crippling neck pain. A motorcycle accident had left Joey Paralisi with severely injured legs. He can now walk without crutches.
As the memorial of your suffering and death.
Pilgrims came to the Santo home to ask Audrey to pray for them and to receive samples of the oil. At first, they came by the dozens, then by the hundreds, until the numbers reached the thousands. Joanne and Stanley Pirog were given a sample of oil by a friend when their 17-year-old son, Jim, lapsed into a coma after a car crash.
They told us that Jim's condition was very, very grave, and it would be a miracle if he survived the night.
Jim was still comatose 7 days later when they placed the oil on his forehead. According to Jim's family, it didn't take long for him to respond. Jesus. The hospital monitors reportedly showed Jim's sudden improvement.
I can still remember the feeling of awe, because I didn't expect that particular effect. And it was just a few hours later that he did come out of his coma. And the nurses used to call him Miracle Kid.
It took Jim a year to improve enough from his injuries to return to high school and to graduate. But one of the most surprising aspects of this story is Audrey herself. After 11 years of being bedridden, she has few of the expected ill effects.
The girl's never had a bed sore, and for someone who doesn't move around and have a trach and stuff, she really has not had any kind of pneumonia or cold or anything in 3 years, which is really in itself a remarkable thing.
Update. After surviving for 2 decades in her comatose state, Audrey Santo passed away in April of 2007. She was 23 years old. A chapel has been set up in Audrey's former bedroom, and pilgrims still come from across the country seeking cures. Not all of our cases are solved. If you have any information about any of the other stories we've profiled, please log on to our website at unsolved.com.